our community, our hometown. This is Kearney Live on 102.7 FM, our hometown radio station. Kearney Live is presented by Kearney Trust, 310 West 92 Highway in Kearney, 816-628-6666. And now here's the hosts of Kearney Live, Mike Davis and Jim Dickerson.
There they are, right up there. The studio audience, every week they come back. We love them, Jim. Aren't they wonderful?
They are.
Thank you. Yes.
Did you see the sign up there?
I did. Yes. It said, Will Akin for Sheriff. I think, didn't
yes,
it?
Yes,
I think it did.
Captain Will Akin is with us today, and we're going to talk to you about your sheriff candidacy here at Clay County. And give us a little couple of minutes here, because I think we want to, first of all, introduce you all to the wonderful show, KPGZ right here, Kearney Live. We do this every Wednesday at noon. It is the best show in Kearney at noon on Wednesdays. It's the only one. But you know what? We got a lot of listeners. And we're also on Facebook Live every Wednesday as well. And that episode is saved. So if you miss it, if you're at work and you're not even hearing us now, that makes no difference. When you get home, you can get right on there and see what we talked about. And we also have Brian Watts, the hardest working man in Kearney, right? Never has to buy a meal, never has to buy a lunch, never has to buy a cocktail, but he doesn't really drink anything. He'll drink a Coke, though. I've seen him do it. And you know what? He doesn't have to pay for it because everybody is in line to buy that guy. Whatever it is that he wants, he's that good. Yes, he is. Jim Dickerson, my good friend and the co-host of this show, Kearney Live, is with me with a few announcements. We have a couple of things going on, and Jim, I'm going to turn it over to you for the moment.
Well, thank you very much. I wanted to bring you up on a couple of things. Number one, don't forget to join us tomorrow at noon for the Coach Grace Show. He'll be in to talk about their game against Reed's Spring and how that went on Friday. A good victory for your Kearney Bulldogs. And then on Friday, don't forget to join us at 6:40 for the pregame, 7 o'clock for the game. On 102.7 FM KPGZ, as we bring you live coverage of the last home game of the Kearney Bulldogs in the regular season. We'll see how things shake out for when we get to district play and that sort of thing. Going to be a little different this year because we have so many teams that have either missed games, skipped game, had to reschedule. Obviously, the Reed Spring game was way out of conference, division, or anything else. And another note, and this is actually kind of funny, got not sure how we got this. It says email, but it could be. But it says, Jim is really great. Mike, not so much. No, that's not what it said. I'm just kidding. Somebody, and this is probably my fault, so I'll take credit for this. But somebody said, you guys talk a lot about the pictures or video. How am I supposed to see it on the radio? Good question. So I'm going to answer that for you.
Unless the technology has changed.
Well, the funny thing is, so we do the video. We do it for Facebook Live. We've got the YouTube channel for KPGZ. We have a Vimeo channel now. We have KPGZ TV. We have all these things going on. And we get so hung up sometimes in the video component, we actually...
Because we can see them.
Yeah, because we can see it. And we've got monitors in the studio, and we can see what's going on. And we just tend to think everybody else can see it. For the radio listeners, I apologize. That's my fault. Because I was thinking last week on the Coach Gray Show, I talked a lot about the pictures from the quarterback club that we get. And if you were on radio, you're probably like, what is he talking about? And so when we show video highlights of things, probably a little difficult to see on the radio. However, KPGZ TV is out there. If you'd like to check it out, go to our YouTube channel. The easiest way, unless you want to go look at things that are historical, just go to the website, 1027kearneymo.com. Right in the bottom center is KPGZ. Click on that. It'll take you to what's current, and it'll just go through, and then it's got Kearney Live episodes, the weekly news recap, Coach Gray's show. There's a feature on the Kearney Museum, all sorts of good stuff. Yeah. So 1027kearneymo.com. Also make sure to check out our news. And that's all I got. Let's get with the program. And now back to the one and only Mike Davis.
If I could do the Johnny Carson Tonight Show voice like you do, Jim. I would say that's great stuff.
That is wild stuff. I did not know that.
Yeah.
That is wild.
One of the best Johnny Carson imitations.
Joan Embry is with us here today.
Yes. I love that. Yeah. Multi-talented. And also the voice of the Kearney Bulldogs. Right. That's Jim Dickerson.
I don't do Johnny Carson when I do the Bulldogs. You know who I should do?
I would love to hear you do it in a Johnny Carson voice, though. You know, Acosta in the quarterback. Whatever, how it starts, you know. Acosta, under center.
So, well, yeah.
Do it again.
Well, I don't know.
Come on. Give me a play call.
He would probably do it something like he would go, I don't know if you, Ian Acosta. I don't know if you ever heard of Ian. Ian was behind a quarterback. And then, Sanders would have to come on. There were too many points scored by one opponent. Therefore, I am going to give the other opponent the extra points. We have a tie ball game. Everybody wins. It's a beautiful thing.
Outstanding. Yes. Yes. Love that.
And before we go, a long distance dedication, I'm Casey Kasem. And now, Will Akin, a man who...
I'm telling you, that is fantastic. I'm always reluctant to encourage Jim, but look what happens when you do. He's just he's a font of talent. I mean, look at the guy.
He's an out of control.
Yeah, that's great. That was good stuff. Hey, good stuff there. Will, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. I always look forward to hanging out with you guys.
Well, I don't know why. Nobody else wants to hang out with
me. Come on. I mean, it takes me back to my childhood. Casey Kasem. I mean, let's go.
He's sitting over there going, what are these guys talking about?
Well, and yeah, we have a guest sitting in here in the guest chair, which Will Akin is sitting in. And I often wonder what they're thinking when Jim and I are going back and forth and they're thinking, wait a minute, I thought I was supposed to be on this show. So, but you are on this show, and you are running for sheriff of Clay County, Missouri, and right now you are captain at the Clay County Sheriff's Office, and you've been there for how long, Will?
Been there almost 8 years. January 1st will make 8 years.
Wow, time flies, doesn't it?
It does.
I know.
It's gone by quick, but it's been great.
Right. At what point did you decide, I'd like to be sheriff, and I'm going to put my hat on the ring for that? When did you make that decision?
Oh, wow. That was probably the summertime of 2018. So the current sheriff, Paul Vescovo, was talking about retiring, and we were sitting down, and he said, you know, I think it's time for me to step down and retire. And he goes, what do you think? I said, well, what do you think about what? And I knew where he was going.
Yes.
And it was something that it wasn't taken lightly, you know, did a lot of thinking. Talking with my wife, you know, kind of evaluating the whole situation, and ultimately the decision was made, and I couldn't be happier. I mean, this is exactly what I want to do.
That's fantastic. Now, you are not only Captain Will Akin now, you are Dr. Will Akin.
Yes. So the last time I think I was on the show, it was soon to be doctor because my degree wasn't conferred upon me.
Right.
But now it is.
Yes.
So, yeah.
So, happy. So which takes precedent?
It would be captain.
Okay, captain, doctor.
Yeah. I feel like I'm in a MASH episode. Yeah. Doctor, captain, doctor, doctor. Yes.
And doctor.
Yes.
One of the things, glad I'm not sick.
Do you make house calls? Oh, it's not that kind
not
of doctor.
Not that kind of doctor.
Put your clothes back on.
Well, we're 10 minutes into this show, and it's already left the track.
I do have to ask, though, what year are we in? Because they're talking about MASH. We're talking about Casey Kasem.
Yes.
We threw a little Spies Like Us in there.
Yep.
Yeah.
One thing, if we could just focus for, I don't know, half a second. I think your story, a lot of people, you know, would like to know kind of your background. The time on the sheriff's department is great. Can you go back? Talk a little bit before that, because you served in the military and that sort of thing. So just tell us a little quick rundown of your history.
Yeah, quick rundown. Okay, so let's see. My father left when I was 3, left my mom, my brother, and I. By 8, we were homeless. By 16, I dropped out of high school. By 18, I got my GED, joined the Army, spent 8.5 years in the Army, where I was a Black Hawk helicopter pilot. And then after that, went into law enforcement and been in law enforcement for 17 and a half years. And yeah, that's kind of where I'm at in a nutshell.
And I don't want to dwell on this part of it, but you could probably do just as well doing motivational speaking, I would think, on...
Wait a minute. He does.
Well, that's true. But for kids that, you know, just think they're down and out and it's over, or there's no use of doing this, you went from you getting your GED to becoming a doctor, getting a doctorate, I guess, if we want to say it that way. But it just goes to show you can put your mind to something and turn everything around.
Don't let the current situation or the circumstances prevent you from being something that you want to be. I actually get invited to different high schools, Northland Caps, and different church groups to do, I wouldn't call it motivational speaking. I mean, it's just me going presenting and telling my story. But let me see, a few months ago, I was actually told that a few students from Liberty North High School, because of my presentation, because of my story, it actually motivated them, inspired them to join the military. And three of them actually went into the Army. So when I hear stories like that, it's like, wow, you know, here I am just sharing my story. But when I hear the influence that I had on somebody who said, you know what, I can do that too, and they follow their dreams.
Mm-hmm. You know, we visited with you, I think, just briefly on another occasion. I don't think it was it on Kearney Live? And we talked a little bit about your background, especially from the point at which your father had basically walked out of your life, and which would be a tragedy for any child. I mean, I can't imagine how horrible that must have felt. Even at that young age, it seems to me that when we spoke before, you sort of took it all in stride, and sort of go back to that just for a little bit here, because I want you to sort of share that those feelings that you had and how you adapted to a terrible, terrible situation.
Yeah, you know, not having a father figure around, I didn't know what I didn't know, right? So it was just mom, single mom, two boys, and we just lived life. I mean, we were regular kids. We played outside. You know, there was nothing nothing crazy or nothing really different than how other kids are today. But it wasn't until I started having memories of my mom crying in her bedroom because we didn't have enough food for her to eat. And my brother and I are in the kitchen, and I remember walking down the hallway and seeing my mom, and then she, you know, would close the door. And so those memories, you know, kind of made me start realizing that there's got to be more to this. And then that's when I started stepping up. And ultimately, I think we were homeless for about 2 years. But homeless wasn't like living on the streets. We were living in the back of a station wagon. Mm-hmm. And I mean, again, it was like camping. It really wasn't being homeless, because at night we got to sleep behind my mom's workplace. And in the morning we got McDonald's, and she took us to school, and then she went to sleep behind the school in the car. So I didn't really put it all together until I was probably 11. Right. That's when I started realizing the things that we didn't have, started, you know, being bullied because I was wearing, you know, clothes that didn't match what everyone else wore. And that's when I started making the decision, or made up my mind, hey, you know what? I have to get myself out of this, but I didn't want to leave my family behind. So I started working. And I remember, you know, I started a little tree trimming, and I was carrying a chainsaw the size that I was. And I remember climbing 80-100 foot palm trees and trimming them up. And then I would go and carry bags of concrete to help the guys that were plastering houses and laying carpet in hotels. And it just kind of went from there. And I really liked working. Didn't like school.
Yeah.
And ultimately ended up dropping out of high school. But I was actually working three jobs at the time. Mm-hmm. So
I'm curious, when you said you were parked in the station wagon, you were living out of the family car behind your mother's place of employment. Now, did they have any idea that she was parked back there, that she was without a house?
No, I don't think so. My mom, she didn't tell anybody our problems and stuff like that. And even during the colder months, we would still live in the car, but some people that she knew would let us park in the garage at least.
Oh, man.
So we were still sleeping in our car, but at least we weren't freezing.
Yeah. So it sounds like, I mean, obviously you found work that you liked and it helped to support your family. And at what point did, I'm going to assume your mother was still working and you were adding to the family income by the jobs that you did, right?
No, actually she wasn't. She was disabled by the time I got to the point where I could work multiple jobs.
Wow. And you were how old then?
That point, 17 years old.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Such a responsibility. So I guess as you just kind of reflect back on it, that period of just, you know, really about 15 or so years of your life, you had to take on an incredible amount of responsibility. What, as you look back on it, what is the, if there was one thing you could point to and you could say, that's what helped push me through the rest of my life as I was looking ahead, that's the thing that helped me to just push on every time when things got tough.
Man, I don't know if I can think of one thing, but mm-hmm. it was always the motivation of not wanting to stay in that circumstance. There was something else. So mm-hmm. it was almost like a moving goal. Oh, great example. Remember the picture of the horse with the carrot on a stick?
Yeah.
And they just kept going after it. So yes. Yeah, I had a lot of motivation. I had a lot of passion and I was doing what I thought I was doing right.
Yeah.
But I didn't really have a reason or a goal because it just kept moving.
Right.
And it wasn't until, you know, circumstances finally just, you know, I had to get out of my neighborhood. It was a bad neighborhood and I knew I was going nowhere fast. And that's mm-hmm. when I went to the recruiter's office and they said, you have to have your GED before you can join the Army. And so I went straight over, got my GED. And then that's when I joined the Army.
Well, we are visiting today with Captain Will Akin, and he is a candidate for Clay County Sheriff here, right here in Clay County. And we're going to take a short break. Right, Brian? Yes, we are. He's shaking his head. Yes. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Captain Akin.
Say thank you to these local businesses who support KPGZ.
Simplify your banking, simplify your life. It's easy with Kearney Trust Company. The world has become fast-paced, and we understand that you are busy. That's why we offer a banking experience that's as simple and stress-free as can be. Kearney Trust goes beyond convenient locations and good customer care to offer banking services that make managing your finances quicker and easier than ever before. Online, bill pay, e-statements, and mobile banking are available to give you a positive banking experience so you can get back to your life and activities. Kearney Trust also provides capital to people and businesses so they can achieve their goals. Whether you know exactly what you want or just need someone to talk to about your dream, you can speak with them and work on that dream. You may just be getting off the ground or ready to move into your brick and mortar building. Kearney Trust will provide you and your business with the resources you need to succeed. Kearney Trust Company is your partner for success with two convenient locations in Kearney at 310 West 92 Highway and 701 Watson Drive in Price Chopper. The phone is 816-628-6666. Kearney Trust Company, banking you can trust. Member FDIC.
Scary. Yeah. There's some scary pictures. For those of you who are on radio, listening into the radio, you can't see the scary pictures.
Can't see that.
Nope, can't see it. But you can when you come back to the Facebook page this evening or whenever you want to. When you come back, for those of you who are watching us on Facebook Live, we are back with Captain Will Akin, your Clay County candidate for sheriff right here.
None of us in the studio has a proton nuclear generator on our back.
We got none of it. Got none of that. But, okay.
Cross the streams.
Exactly.
All right,
right.
Let's move on.
And I do remember that movie. That was a lot of fun. But back to Captain Dr. Akin, I am telling you that your story is such a fascinating one. And it is truly a profile in character. And I'm not trying to embarrass you here, but I think there are aspects of your story that will clearly apply to the, and we will get to the fact that yes, you're running for sheriff. We're going to let you campaign here in a minute, but the story is so fascinating. I think it just sort of sets the groundwork for where you are now. And Jim, what were we talking about off the air? I think just set it up for us.
One of the things off the air we were talking a little bit about, and I've seen this happen when you go to people give motivational speeches or whatever the case may be, and they do it to kids, like high school kids or something like that. They'll say to a kid, you can be whatever you want to be. And then, although that's true, what the part they leave out is, But you have to go through the steps.
Yes.
So what will happen is a kid will apply, and I want to be an astronaut, and they'll apply to NASA, and they get turned down, and then it's over. I can't do anything. But you have to do everything in steps. You know, nobody who – you pick anybody you want. Nobody became successful overnight. They had all these steps and all the right. things they did along the way. So your story, the thing I really like about your story is you were at a place where you can't go much lower than that. And you've now gotten to a place where there's not a lot higher. Well, I guess you're not an astronaut yet.
Come on, Will, you underachiever. Get with it, would you, buddy?
Time is right. all the essence, son. But no.
Oh,
but
you've gone,
I mean, the steps you've taken to get where you are from where you came from is the world's, I mean, that is a perfect stepladder of how to do it. And if someone puts their mind to it, they can do it. And I think that's so important for people to understand. If you put your mind to it, you can do it. And certain things, and I'm sure you would agree, things weren't rosy the whole way up. You had little hiccups along the way, as we all have. But the problem is we tend to sugarcoat things so much that
a lot of shortcuts. Yeah.
When people hit a roadblock, they're like, I'm done.
Right,
I'm out.
Right.
So your story, I think, is a great motivational thing for people to follow, but realize it's not all going to be easy the whole way up. I mean, I'm sure you've had some obstacles along the way.
Lots of obstacles, you know, but one thing that I want to say is don't ever underestimate yourself. You know, and don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. Don't be afraid to start off at the bottom and work your way up. You know, I didn't go from homelessness to Dr. Captain Will Akin, candidate for Clay County Sheriff. No, there were a lot of steps in between. I mean, I've had, 35 years to work on it.
Right.
You know, and it's not something that happens overnight. And that's one of the things that I try to let the students know, or anyone that I share my story with, is be patient as possible. I mean, it's always easier said than done, right? But don't be afraid to go out and try something. Don't let anything hold you back.
Right. You also spent a good deal of time in the military, and beginning with Korea, right? Take us through that just real quickly.
So starting from Korea or yes. when I first enlisted?
Let's start there. I like
All
it
All right. Yeah. Okay. So in, 2000, I went to South Korea. I was stationed at Camp Stanley in Wujongbu. And it was right after flight school, so it was still peacetime. And the only place that you can go to get hours in whatever airframe that you were in was Korea. So I volunteered to go to Korea. And when I was over there, it was a lot of fun. We did air assault missions. We did a lot of stuff along the DMZ, which got some memories of, you know, it's crazy times, especially when you're technically still in a war zone at that time. But then also got to start or fight fires. Mm-hmm. And we had Bambi buckets underneath our helicopter putting out fires that, we may have started at the artillery range, but nonetheless, we were there, you know, and really just got to experience the culture mm-hmm. and something that was different than the United States, which really broadened my horizons as to what we have in the States mm-hmm. isn't like that in other parts of the world.
Right. And then take it a bit further, and you were in the Gulf War, correct?
Nope.
Okay, well, take me a little further.
Okay, further back, further forward?
Further forward.
Okay. All right, so I got out of the Army in 2003 after they diagnosed me with adult onset asthma at 26. I couldn't fly anymore, so they told me I had to get out and find a new job. Started my law enforcement career with the Phoenix Police Department. I'm not from Phoenix. That's just happens to be the place that I started my career. But 7 years later, I was a police advisor in Afghanistan.
Okay.
And so that's my time overseas. But, I worked with the Department of Defense, Department of State, Europol, MOI, all of our international partners.
And that's exactly what I'm talking about. So in your career, you had a hiccup. When you had the diagnosis, there's a lot of people that would be like, that's it, I'm
right.
out. But
right.
you said, okay, well, now I'm going to do this. But I think the point is there, you were able to use experiences and life experiences from the past and your expertise and use it in another way, which worked out in that avenue.
Yeah.
Not what your original plan was, but it still worked out.
No, my original plan, I'd still be in the military today flying.
Yeah. Ah, okay.
But you know, every time there has been an obstacle or something that has made me change my path, okay, you know, was I upset? Absolutely, because I loved the military. But then when I got into law enforcement, I set my eyes on something new. And I said, you know what? I'm going to be the best that I can be at this now. And so 7 years later, went to Afghanistan. I'm going to be the best that I can be over there and just learn the culture and learn as much as I can, but always learning something along the way.
We had a question from one of the listeners, and so I'm going to try to do my best to weave this in. And that's where I was sort of headed earlier. And basically the question is, talk about mental health. Well, I'm going to guess that anytime you talk about law enforcement or the military, you're obviously dealing with, or people who are homeless for that matter, going further back in your amazing career and life. We always talk about sort of your position in life and things like that. What people tend to overlook is that there is often a mental health aspect to all of these things. And it doesn't mean that, you know, that you're born with any particular sort of malady, but just your situation brings on the kinds of stresses that, like any one of us who is stressed enough, we're going to break. And it does cause these kinds of things. So for the benefit of this listener, I would say, let's talk just a little bit about the mental health aspect of military, some of the veterans and law enforcement as well.
Yeah, you know, mental health is so important, not only for law enforcement, military, but for everyone, the community. You know, I'm not immune to the effects of traumatic experiences, right? And I've had my share of dark moments. But I think with my life experience now, I can always recall back to a time where I was like, at least it's not that. And, you know, just moving on. But I know that everyone deals with stress. Everyone deals with those kind of feelings and being down in a dark place differently. But, you know, in law enforcement, we have crisis intervention team. And for the last 3 years, I've been the law enforcement co-chair of the Tri-County CIT Council. And I think it's extremely important for law enforcement to have that, not only the education, the skills to deal with the public when they're in that situation, but also knowing introspectively what's happening to them, or at least your partner seeing the signs in somebody next to them doing the job. So, yeah, definitely want to reinforce that. And we've got a great peer support group as well. So whenever any law enforcement, any public safety, EMS, fire, if they've experienced a traumatic experience, we have a core group that we can call upon and say, hey, you know what? You'd be the perfect person to go over there, because we may not always relate to each other, but if we have a similar background, that's when that relation can come into play. But it's extremely important. I mean, we have to take care of ourselves, you know, be self-aware and that mental health aspect.
Yeah. And that's part of the training, I'm sure, that to be aware of those cues and the times when you think, okay, the load is getting just a little bit too heavy here and you need a little help. And I'm imagining there is that you don't attach any sort of judgment to it, obviously. And yet I think as individuals, we all want to be strong. We want to be the guy, the tough one, or the girl, or whoever that can get through it, and we can push through by ourselves. And that's not always the case for a lot of people. How do we sort of help those people along to say, you know what, just relax, we'll help you through this thing? How do you sort of communicate that to them?
Yeah, and I think you touched on it, right? Because we want to look strong, or more importantly, we don't want to look weak, especially in law enforcement or military or whatever the job is. But we have to find a way to break those barriers down and say, hey, you're still human.
Right.
And we have to work through this, because if not, you're going to go down a path that you more than likely won't be able to recover from. And we've seen it. It leads to drugs. It leads to alcohol. It leads to other things that ends up ending their careers. Right. And we don't want that. Or worse yet, you know, taking out that stress and manifesting it in a way that is not appropriate when they're dealing with a situation in the public.
Right.
You know, so we still have to look out for each other.
Yeah. Fascinating. And you like to think that we've made a lot of progress. I mean, just as humans, when we look at law enforcement, when we look at veterans who are struggling, how much is it changing? Are we making progress since, you know, let's say 10 years ago?
I wholeheartedly think we're making progress. Yeah. The problem is we still have this mentality a culture that we have to push through. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, we have made progress, but we still have a lot more that we can do and that needs to be done.
Right.
And, you know, one of the things that I talk about with, especially with younger officers and younger deputies, is don't be so self-absorbed in law enforcement. You have to have a life outside of law enforcement because, you know, if you live, breathe, eat law enforcement, then you're going to implode at some point. But having friends outside of law enforcement to kind of keep you grounded, you know, or at least your mind off the things that are happening, I think it's extremely important. But yeah, we've made progress.
You know, that's an interesting thing because I remember when I first started, there were guys that were just 24 hours a day. Yeah. I mean, and you could tell. My biggest thing, and I try to do it now, but my biggest thing was when I left at whatever time it was, I didn't want to hear about it. You know, obviously, if someone you knew something happened to them, that's different. But I didn't want to hear about it, talk about it, think about it mm-hmm. until I went back. Now, my understanding is you're running for some sort of office of some sort. That's going to be a little difficult for you. You're going to have to pay attention to it. But so what office are you running for again?
I am running for the Clay County Sheriff's Office.
Yeah, that's correct. And that election day would be?
November 3rd.
Outstanding. So, yeah, I thought we'd get back to that a little bit. So,
well, it all leads up to
leads up. Yeah, good segue, Jim.
Sure is. Yeah, well done, Jim.
Put that into my bonus check.
We're going to double your salary.
Anyway, so lost my whole train of thought. Thanks, Mike.
There went that pay raise.
Anyway.
Yep, right so, down the drain.
There goes Christmas. Running for office in Clay County, Sheriff. Yes. And we've already talked about Paul is retiring.
Paul is retiring after a successful 42 years.
Wow. Yeah,
that's impressive. Talk a little bit about, so let's just talk about things that are going on, current things that are going on. We've got some budget things going on with the county, and we won't get into the details of it, but let's talk a little bit about what your vision is moving forward, because you're if you were to win, you will take over the sheriff's department, sheriff's office. I've been chastised for that before, too, the sheriff's office. what's your vision moving forward? What are some things you want to continue? What do you want to improve on? Where do you want to go with the office?
There's just so much to talk about that we don't have enough time in the day. But where I want to take the sheriff's office is we have a great foundation for what we have now, but there's so much more that we can achieve. And having a new relationship, a new commission, working with the sheriff's office, we're going to be able to do that. You know, one of the things that I really want to do is with everything happening in our country, I don't want people to wonder what is the sheriff's office anymore. So my vision is to start inviting members of the community in to let us know or let them know what we do. Because there are a lot of people who think, oh, where's the sheriff's office at? Oh, and I tell them, they go, oh, isn't that the Liberty Police Department? What does the sheriff do? Well, I want to end that, you know, as much as I possibly can. And, you know, so we're going to continue doing our citizen action or our citizen academy. Citizens Academy. And one of the things that I want to do is create a Citizens Action Committee, and not to provide oversight of the sheriff's office, but for me to really for accountability, you know, I can present to them and then try to find out what the gaps are. You know, are we meeting the community's expectations? And if we're not, well, share with us, because we only know what we know. We can only go off of, you know, statistical analysis on how many calls we've gone to. And if you think, you know, today, a lot of people think, well, why isn't law enforcement doing it? Why isn't we're just a small piece of the pie, right? So I think with the partnership that we can have with our community, to include small business community, because it's, you know, small businesses, they get victimized too. But, all of us working together, that final product is going to be far more effective than us just trying to do and, quite frankly, react to anything that's happening. Because, you know, you talk about budget, and even without going into the details, we still have to have a budget in order to be efficient. And hopefully with the new year, we'll be able to fix all those problems and start implementing some of the ideas that I have. And making us shine even brighter.
How are you guys doing as far as personnel? Because I know A lot of departments. The funny thing was, when I remember years ago when I started, there were just gobs of people trying to get a minimal number of jobs. Now it's the reverse. And especially with everything that's going on, it just doesn't seem like an appealing situation. So how do you recruit people to Clay County and say, this is where you want to be and this is what you want to do?
Well, okay, so our benefits are amazing. Our retirement's amazing, but new deputies, they don't want to see what's going to happen in 20, 25, 30 years down the road. They want to see a paycheck right now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, part of that budget process is I'm going to provide a plan to the commission so that we can all work together to come up with something that's feasible for Clay County. For example, Platte County Sheriff's Office just increased their starting salary for deputies to $45,000 a year. That's great. The Clay County Sheriff's Office starts our deputies off at $35,400 roughly. That's almost a $10,000 disparity. Mm-hmm. And when you talk about hiring, you talk about benefits, but how much am I making? And then when we tell them that, they go, ooh, yeah, well, you know, we're going to go look over here at this agency or this agency. So, you know, hiring, that's extremely difficult right now because out of roughly 220 positions that we have, only 200 are filled. So that essentially leaves us 20 vacancies or soon to be 20 vacancies. How do we fill those?
Right.
If we're not paying people the appropriate salaries, at least to, and I don't want to be the highest paid agency. I just want to be competitive.
Yes.
Because as of right now, we're not even the stepping stone. Mm. And those are the challenges that we're up against to try to get people in.
We're talking today with Captain Will Akin. He's a candidate for the sheriff of Clay County. And appreciate you being here with us today, with Will. We're going to be right back. And I'd like to pick up where we left off here, too, on personnel and leadership. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Without the support of community underwriters, we wouldn't be here. So a huge thanks to these particular businesses for supporting KPGZ.
Simplify your banking. Simplify your life. It's easy with Kearney Trust Company. The world has become fast-paced, and we understand that you are busy. That's why we offer a banking experience that's as simple and stress-free as can be. Kearney Trust goes beyond convenient locations and good customer care to offer banking services that make managing your finances quicker and easier than ever before. Online, bill pay, e-statements, and mobile banking are available to give you a positive banking experience so you can get back to your life and activities. Kearney Trust also provides capital to people and businesses so they can achieve their goals. Whether you know exactly what you want or just need someone to talk to about your dream, you can speak with them and work on that dream. You may just be getting off the ground or ready to move into your brick and mortar building. Kearney Trust will provide you and your business with the resources you need to succeed. Kearney Trust Company is your partner for success with two convenient locations in Kearney at 310 West 92 Highway and 701 Watson Drive in Price Chopper. The phone is 816-628-6666. Kearney Trust Company, banking you can trust. Member FDIC.
Yeah, very scary Halloween bumper music right there, Brian.
That's Mike singing.
Very scary.
He did the cover for that. Great job, Mike.
Yeah, that was the other Mike. That was Michael. He goes by Mike. Nicely done, sir. Like that. And we're back on Kearney Live. We've got Captain Will Akin with us. He's in studio today. We're talking about his candidacy for Clay County Sheriff. And Election Day is right around the corner, November 3rd. What is the date today? 14th. Halfway through October. Can you really believe
it's
it?
It's almost time.
I know it. And we're talking about all manner of things that have led up to your candidacy for sheriff in Clay County. And I would also ask you, I mean, at you are captain at the Clay County Sheriff's Office. I mean, you're in a leadership role already. How will that transition impact the rest of the sheriff department office, I should say, as you see? I mean, it seems fairly seamless to me that you would go from captain to sheriff. I mean, of course, it seems logical.
Yes, you know, that's the logical step, but right. The sheriff's position's elected. So you don't, there's not, you know, after major or lieutenant colonel, there's no guarantee that you will ever be the sheriff because you have to go through the election process. But because of my experience as a lieutenant and captain with Clay County Sheriff's Office and running the units that I have and being involved in really the office operations, mm-hmm. I have a very good, solid understanding of everything. I may not be a specialist in certain areas, right. but I do have that general understanding.
Yeah. How do you think that has impacted your candidacy? And I think as you've been campaigning, is there a name? Sounds silly, but is there a name recognition aspect to your campaigning that you've noticed when you've been out and about in the community?
And that's a great question. So I never had any desire to run for sheriff. Mm-hmm. In fact, my law enforcement career, my intention was to be a chief of police someday. But like I had explained earlier, or described earlier, the conversation between Sheriff Escova and I, the timing was right. And I love the Clay County Sheriff's Office and I love Clay County. As I have said before, I've moved 38 times in 45 years, living in 10 wow. states and three countries. And, and we have finally planted roots here and we do not yeah. want to leave. So yeah. that's what I wanted to do. But you know, the transition, the experience, mm-hmm. you know, it's something that I can build upon, but the conversation, the name recognition,
yeah.
it's so going back to no intention, right? So I was just doing the best job that I could do to bring positive light to the sheriff's office and to law enforcement. But the byproduct of that is the people got to know me.
Yeah.
And then in my position as the director of emergency management for Clay County, I responded to every single man-made and natural disaster in Clay County since 2015.
Right.
And we've had quite a few to yeah. include the virus. You know, that's yeah. something that we've been dealing with since March. And actually a little bit before, but, you know, really primarily since March. So when people see you in that environment, they see how you operate and how you treat other people, especially, you know, it's not all about me, because there have been many situations where I walked into a situation where I pulled the emergency manager for that jurisdiction aside and just said, what can I do to help you?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the reputation that I have built. But then now that I'm running for office, it's paying off. You know,
yeah,
but that was never my goal. That was never my intention.
The high profile that you have has been somewhat incidental.
Yes.
I mean, yeah. when you think about it. Yeah.
But, you know, on a different note, mm-hmm. it's now I can't change. So once I'm elected right. sheriff, and that expectation is already set.
Yes.
And I was actually talking with some reporters from the Courier Tribune this morning, mm-hmm. Did an interview with them. And I, you know, one of the questions was how does the Clay County Sheriff's Office communicate with the public? And do you feel like you do a good enough job, you know, sending the message out? And I said, absolutely, because I'm the one who started the Facebook and Twitter page back in 2013, became the spokesperson for the Sheriff's Office, in 2014. And I have been accessible or have built relationships with all the media partners and have been accessible by phone, by email, by online and social media. You know, early on as a public information officer, I was told never give your phone number to reporters because they're going to blow it up at 2 o'clock in the morning. And so I was extremely hesitant. But then when I started doing it, I was like, okay, one, it's a lot easier. And two, they're not blowing my phone up at 2 o'clock in yeah. the morning. They respect the fact that it's 2 o'clock in the morning. They're not going to bother me for something that's, you know, they can easily find out. So that relationship has just, it's expanded over the years. And now that expectation is set, but I'm not going to stop. You know, I'm still going to remain accessible. And if you look at my personal social media and my campaign social media, mm-hmm. when somebody asks a question, I'm there and I try to, you know, answer within minutes of them asking. So I'm going to continue that.
Right. So they can find you on Facebook, or do you have a website for your campaign, or what's a way that people could find you online?
Yeah. My website is willakinforsheriff.com. On Facebook, it's Will Akin for Sheriff. On Twitter, it's Will Akin for Sheriff. On Instagram, it's Will Akin for Sheriff. And then all my personal social media accounts, and I'm on nearly all of them.
Yeah. That's, I think even I could remember that. Yeah. So, as you're getting closer and closer to Election Day, you and I talked about this briefly, I think, I don't know, a couple of weeks ago when we saw you over there at the 9/11 celebration, I guess, for lack of a better word. Yeah. But as you're getting closer to Election Day, are you still campaigning? And should you still be campaigning leading up to that very day?
Oh, absolutely. You know, one of the things that I don't want people to think is, oh, he thinks he's got it in the bag or something right. like that. You know, I want to continue to show the people that I'm working for them to not only trust me with their vote, but to let them know that I'm still here, you know, and it's not just in Liberty where I live. It's all the communities within Clay County. You know, going back to disasters, right? I've been in every single municipality in some shape, form or another, and I'm not going to stop. And just because we're campaigning and we're getting so close, nope, I'm still going to be working as hard now as I have been, you know, a year ago.
One of the things I wanted to kind of go back, because I know a lot of people are concerned about this as it relates to, because it relates to taxes and government and all that sort of thing. And a lot of people hear a lot these days about the funding, the budgets for police departments. Now, let's not talk about defunding, because that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard, but I digress. But one of the things that you brought up that I think is very important and important for people to understand is when you talk about the amount of money that a deputy makes and then the ability to increase it, well, the common thought is, well, that's 10,000 a deputy times so many deputies, 200 in this case, or 220, I think is what you said. But there's other costs that are affected as well. And you talked about overtime. So you actually pay more in a lot of cases in overtime than you would if you just paid the deputies. Plus, you're overworking your deputies anytime you pay overtime. Those are some of the things that I don't think people truly realize. There's ways to constructively budget and work to make so that it makes for a better department or better sheriff's office.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, when people think that it's just $10,000, but you have to think about everything that goes along with that on the backside as far as benefits go. And if you're not able to do that, so then now we're going back to mental health, right? The overtime is great, but we're spending hundreds of thousands of dollars every year in overtime to make up for the vacancies because we still have a job to do. That adds to burnout. That adds to low morale. Now, of course, we can't control an individual's morale, but at least we can do what we can possibly do to say, why are you feeling like this? Because there's probably some other underlying issues. But it all goes hand in hand. So if we were just to be able to, you know, raise or increase the salary, that's not going to be the end all. But at least it's a better starting point. And now we don't have to worry about the amount of overtime that we're doing, barring any catastrophic incident that requires us to work. And then we don't have to worry about mental health and wellness, because now people, from what I understand, you know, no one would probably admit this, but we have deputies right now that are probably close to qualifying for WIC or some other kind of assistance.
Oh boy.
You know, and here is, this is an occupation where you go out and you try to help people, but you know, how well are you or how efficient are you going to be able to help people when you've got that on the back of your mind?
Oh yeah.
Well, not only that, but that kind of goes along with it too. So now you've got overtime, but now you got more people taking sick time, which yes. causes more people to take overtime, which it just makes it worse and worse, where if you could stop it and put a stop to it, get more people in there, then it resolves all these problems, including morale.
Yeah. I mean, it's a never ending cycle. And until we are able to address that, which, you know, there's going to be a request made of the commission, but it's not going to be, okay, this is it. And this is, you know, there's no negotiation.
Right.
There's going to be plenty of negotiation, mm-hmm. you know, because it's not just people or paying personnel, because there are some other issues, equipment and just some of the technology and the things that we're using right now, that all has to be updated because we're kind of running behind the times, and there's a better way of doing it. And if you're going to have a law enforcement agency representing your jurisdiction, then it should be the best and representing you the best way possible. So there's going to be a lot of things that we're going to be working through, but I have a plan, and that's going to be a plan that I'm going to discuss with the next commission. And, you know, it's going to take perhaps a period of 4 years. Now, you know, we often hear about 5-year, 10-year plans and stuff mm-hmm. like that, but a sheriff's term is only 4 years. And so that's what I'm going to work on. That's what I'm going to focus on. Now, if I win another term, then I'll provide another 4-year plan. But I'm not going to subject the next sheriff, for whatever reason, I'm not able to fulfill my term mm-hmm. to what I've already promised or have been working on.
Right. How will you, how do you go about setting up those meetings then at the very beginning? I'm curious how, what is the sort of kickoff moment with the commission by which you propose your plan? How does that all work out?
That's going to be very quick. So once the election is over and all the candidates know, you know, who were successful in their campaigns and ultimately elected, mm-hmm. that's when we're going to get together. And, you know, we have until, I believe, the end of January to approve 2021's budget.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
We're going through the budget process right now, but it's more of, okay, here's in preparation for next year to have something in order, because to do a budget of $120 million for an entire county, that doesn't just happen during a weekend or a week. You know, that takes a lot of work.
That transitional time then before January then would be a good time then to get to know those folks, new commission.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. I mean, the good news is I already know most of the candidates.
Right.
And, you know, if you look at polls and if you look at social media and if you, like, you know, put your ear to the ground, you kind of have a feeling, a sense of who is likely to be successful.
Who's going to win?
Oh, man. I'll reserve that.
Put you on the spot there for a second. Do you have a chart or a graph we could look at? Got to look at that? No.
Little polls here. Yeah, we can have our own poll right here in the studio. Right. I have a feeling how that would turn out.
No, I will say this, though. No matter who wins in the elections this year, mm-hmm. Clay County is going to be the ultimate winner in the end. We've got a lot of great candidates.
No doubt about that. Yeah. Absolutely true. And, I was about ready to say something about it being so far down. It looks like up from here. Yeah. And the bar is low. Let's just put it that way. And won't it be good?
It will be great.
To clear the decks. Yeah. Yeah.
And that all goes that all goes into effect on January 4th. First for Clay County, correct?
Everyone takes over on January 1st.
Right. Yeah. So it's not like the national where they do it on the 20th.
Yeah.
Yeah. And from what I understand, I believe we're all sworn in on December 31st.
Oh, okay.
Kind of in the afternoon, I believe. So that way there's no gap in, you know, the incumbents leaving or the people who are retiring from the people who are newly elected.
Oh, I see. Okay. Well, good to know. Wow. Yeah.
Nice.
Captain Will Akin, man, it's always a pleasure having you here. And you got such a terrific story. And come back sometime, will you?
Oh, anytime. Thanks, guys, for having me.
Before we go, we'll give you a few seconds to do your little...
Let's do.
Your little stump speech.
Yeah.
I won't interrupt it with any imitations of Casey Kasem or Bernie Sanders. Oh,
darn it.
I won't even do my Will Akin imitation.
But, you know,
just your little, why would we vote for you?
There you go.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity again, guys. It's always a great time coming over here and hanging out with you. But why vote for me for Clay County Sheriff? I'm highly qualified for it. I have my doctorate in ethical leadership, and that's deeply needed in politics today. I have budgeting experience. I have project management experience. I have built relationships with the current elected officials and future elected officials. And that's something that we're going to need in order to take the sheriff's office into 2021 and beyond. You know, this isn't going to be something that we're just going to rely on, oh, this is just the way we've been doing things. Now, we've got a great organization, but we're going to take it places, and we're going to make Clay County shine, especially the Clay County Sheriff's Office. So that's my stump speech.
I just two words used in the same sentence. I don't know if I have ethics and politics in the same sentence.
I've never heard that before.
I don't know how to act.
Oh, man. Well, Dr. Will Akin, thank you again so much for being with us. And we'll have you back, and we see you around, and it's kind of fun. We've gotten to know you, and it's a good time. And actually, we've gotten to know some of the deputy sheriffs and some of the folks around Clay County, and they're great guys too. So
I think
had a good time visiting with them, you know, the last couple of Fridays ago, whenever it was. Man, time gets away so quickly. Listen, thank you, all of you, for listening today and being with us on Kearney Live. And I wanted to thank Kearney Trust Company for being the sponsor of this program. And they have been the sponsor from the very beginning, back when it was live with the mayor. And didn't we have some fun back in those days, Jim? It was terrific.
High above the Alps.
Oh, well done, man. Yeah, another. The best Bill Dane imitation around. Yep, no doubt. Thank you so much. We will be back next week with Megan Thompson. How about that? She's a candidate for Clay County Commissioner, so she'll be one that we'll get to know, and we'll see how that plays out on November 3rd. Don't forget, November 3rd is Election Day. How could you possibly forget? We'll see you next week on Kearney Live. Thank you so much for being with us.